Confronting Cancer, next on Chronicle.
Good evening. Tom Riley says he has never felt better, a far cry from how the Hingham businessman felt 6 years ago when he got a diagnosis of advanced melanoma.
Riley owes his good health today to a chance that he took then. He participated in a potentially risky clinical trial. The idea? To use his body's own immune system to attack the cancer attacking him.
Tom Riley spent the last 6 years savoring special moments. His daughter's wedding, the births of 5 grandkids, dream vacations, and this incredible moment.
Come on, Dad!
The Sox opener in Florida. He throws the first pitch, a strike.
I actually feel as good as I think I've ever felt in my life.
A life he nearly lost after a deadly diagnosis in 2009, advanced melanoma.
He had a very thick, very aggressive melanoma on his back that had spread to the lymph nodes under his arm.
Oncologists used to call it the disease that gives cancer a bad name, almost always fatal.
At the time, there were a lot of major cancer centers around the world, Europe especially, where the standard of treatment for melanoma at this time was to do nothing. It still didn't hit me. I was going to be the guy that was going to die from it. You know, I figured there was going to be a med. And I was not aware that there hadn't been an approval in melanoma for 30 years.
As luck would have it, that was about to change. Mass General was testing a new type of cancer drug, one that hyperstimulates the immune system. There were no guarantees, plenty of risks, and many skeptics, including his oncologist, Dr. Don Lawrence.
He took the risk. He's a savvy individual, and he understood that this was his best chance.
I don't know why anybody fighting any kind of cancer wouldn't ask their oncologist or their team of physicians to kind of go into it with the attitude of nuclear war. I want to win.
The drug, ipilimumab, or IPI for short, essentially takes the brakes off the patient's immune system so it can target the cancer. And the good news?
The majority of people feel well. They do not have chemotherapy-like side effects.
But for some, and doctors cannot predict who, the treatment can have a dark side.
The immune system can be powerful. It can produce autoimmune diseases where the immune system attacks your own healthy cells. And those side effects can be dangerous.
An unregulated immune system is like a fire burning out of control.
As Tom experienced firsthand.
It knocked me down completely flat.
The IPI was killing his cancer cells, but it nearly killed him too. He was hospitalized for 30 days with severe ulcerative colitis.
I lost 50 pounds in 10 weeks. Bleeding out is a real risk.
A risk that proved worth it in the end. He recovered, the colitis gone, and so was the cancer, now 6 years cancer-free.
I feel great. I caught it exactly at the threshold of when things were starting to change, so that's kind of the story of my life.
Not all patients are doing Tom's victory lap, but an increasingly significant number are alive and living well.
I tend to be skeptical about new developments. You gotta show me. First, but I've been shown the light with these drugs. They are really amazing.
Is this the most exciting thing you've seen in years?
Absolutely.
So it is exciting, so encouraging, but right now, IPI, as we call it, only effective in about 20% of those people who are
yes,
getting
so
it.
Yes, so clearly it's not enough. I mean, that is significant. These are people with advanced melanoma and metastatic melanoma, and for them, there were very few options before. So this is really important. The good news for them is that these drugs are being developed now at lightning speed. Mm-hmm. The pharmaceutical companies are excited. The doctors are collaborating. You saw Dr. David Fisher from Mass General there. The day that I was there, he had also been in a pharmaceutical laboratory collaborating with the pharmaceutical companies to make new drugs. So they're happening like this right now. There are other drugs in the pipeline that are coming out.
And Tom, as we heard, had side effects, really tough side effects, but that's not the case for everybody.
No, in fact, my cousin Dana, who lives out in California, consulted with Dr. Lawrence at my request, and he sent her to a California specialist who did the IPI that Tom got. My cousin Dana had melanoma on her elbow. It then went on to spread to her lungs. She did 3 infusions with IPI. No side effects.
Wow.
She felt great. She was never sick. all of the lung tumors are gone. There's not even a shadow. There's no trace of them.
And possibly applicable to many other cancers, and that's being tested now.
They're all being tested now. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can find it in kidney cancer, lung cancer, gastric cancers, leukemia. It's just everyone is excited about this, and this is the future of medicine, immune-based therapy.
Amazing. Well, not even 2 years old, Matthew Zwahlen faced a devastating diagnosis. Heather and Jack Zwahlen were very worried their toddler Matthew simply wasn't himself.
And that was 2 years ago, and it was the beginning of a very long fight to save Matthew.
If you didn't know better, you'd think little Matthew Zwahlen was just like every other kid his age, trying to outdo his sister Lucy. For mom and dad, it's a welcome sight.
He's good, he's back at school, you know, just about a normal kid.
A far cry from 2 years ago, when his parents first noticed something seemed off.
We thought he was teething, you know, and then one weekend he stopped sitting up eating or drinking. And we took him to the doctor Monday morning. He said, go to Children, something doesn't look right.
In fact, something was very wrong, as Boston Children's quickly determined. Matthew had a large cancerous tumor.
11 centimeter diameter on diagnosis in his right adrenal gland, and he's only 19 months old. It was horrible.
And the bad news kept coming.
I can point them here with my little arrow. Those bright spots are all abnormal and shouldn't be there and are sites of bone disease.
Everything that's highlighted here is an indication that there are active cancer cells.
That's right.
The cancer had already spread to the bones in Matthew's skull. High-risk neuroblastoma, one of the most dreaded pediatric diagnoses. But there was one bright spot, says pediatric oncologist Lisa Diller.
Generally speaking, before the antibody, the three-year likelihood of being alive and not having any neuroblastoma was about 45%, and with the antibody, it's about 65%.
The antibody is a pediatric immunotherapy treatment fast-tracked in an unusual move by the FDA because clinical trials were so convincing.
I remember the day that they announced that we were stopping the trial early. And why? Because it worked.
How it works is complicated. Dr. Diller's simplest explanation?
Your body naturally makes antibodies to an infection you might get, like the flu or something like that. And it makes antibodies and it tags the cells that have flu in them, and it helps you get rid of the flu.
Your body doesn't make antibodies to cancer cells, but this new treatment found a way, creating antibodies to neuroblastoma in a laboratory and infusing them into patients.
So now you have neuroblastoma cells tagged by antibody, and then the immune system needs to get rid of them. So in combination with the antibody, we gave immune stimulants, drugs that increase the immune system's ability to clear out antibody-tagged cells and get rid of them. And we were able to do that, for the most part, to the neuroblastoma cells and not any other cell.
Harnessing the immune system to destroy pediatric cancer is picking up speed. At Dana-Farber Boston Children's Cancer and Blood Disorders Center, Dr. Lewis Silverman just opened a clinical trial for kids with acute lymphoblastic leukemia.
There's a particular type of white blood cell called a T cell. We all have T cells. T cells help you fight viruses and other types of infection, and T cells are designed to recognize something in your body that doesn't belong there, something that's foreign. That's why it fights infection. And what we do is we're going to train T cells to recognize the cancer as something foreign and to attack.
It's done like a blood transfusion. T cells are collected, genetically modified, then reinfused. But there are short-term risks.
They can feel like they have a terrible case of the flu, but they can be more sick than that.
And kids like Matthew have already been through hell.
He did chemo, surgery, another round of chemo, stem cell transplant, proton radiation, and then 6 months of antibody therapy.
Which triggered nerve pain so severe he needed intense opiates to control the pain.
The treatment's awful, but it's worth it. I mean, you can't not do it. It's huge. It's a huge prognosis increase.
A 20% better chance Matthew's cancer won't come back.
It was very hard, but you know, it's amazing and it's incredible, and you know, he owes his life to it.
You know, tragically, we all have our connections in some way to cancer. I actually had a niece who died of neuroblastoma, and as we talked about earlier, this was desperately needed, something to help these children.
They couldn't give these kids more chemotherapy. These kids have been maxed out. You heard Matthew's mom talk about the list of therapies that he'd had, 18 months of it, and then 6 months with the immunotherapy. So, you know, these kids have toxic side effects. You may have noticed that Matthew has a hearing aid. He has permanent hearing loss from chemotherapy. So they needed another option. They needed something to boost the chance that he would not have a recurrence.
And that's what they've got, and we're all hoping and praying it continues to work. Immunotherapy shows great promise, as we've said, but there can be some bumps in the road. As we've seen earlier throughout the program, immunotherapy holds out great hope for fighting cancer.
But these patients who are testing out these treatments risk disappointment. And that's something that Diane Legg knows all too well.
For the first time in years, Diane Legg isn't dreading the scans tracking her lung cancer.
Every time I would go in for a scan, it was always nerve-wracking because we didn't know what to expect. We didn't know how much growth there was going to be.
There's been a lot in the last 2 years. Three tumors the size of ping pong balls. But today, she's hopeful.
I wasn't nervous. I wasn't afraid. You know, I couldn't wait to come in and see the results of it.
Because in February, she enrolled in a clinical trial that's profoundly shrunk the size of her tumors.
This is the scan from February 23rd, and this is the scan from April 7th.
And today, even better.
There, if you look at this tumor mouse there, that tumor's responded very well.
It's practically gone.
Yeah.
A total 56% tumor reduction.
It's really remarkably better. It's a very, very good response.
The trial combines a daily Tarceva, the targeted drug proven to attack the EGFR mutation found in her tumors, with a promising but experimental immune therapy infused once every 3 weeks. She's among the first to take them together, a sort of medical pioneer.
It's really kind of trying to come at it from two directions to hopefully really wipe it out.
There are known risks. Each drug has its own side effects. How they'll react together is a mystery.
Absolutely, she's taking a risk.
But are those risks outweighed by the potential benefits?
We don't know. We hope so.
Wait for it.
Tempering today's excitement, she hasn't felt well for weeks. Unexplained fevers and more.
The main thing is I feel dizzy a lot, but I also have some joint pain.
Diane's tough and pushes through the pain.
I'm not ready at all to throw in the towel because I'm having side effects, and the response has been way too incredible. You gotta be nice and gentle to me today.
But she needs good blood work to back her determination. And days later, she learns the choice to power on is no longer hers.
The labs that we drew today showed some inflammation in the liver. So I think today we have a pretty simple decision. Mm-hmm. We're not going to do the treatment today.
You're not?
No.
What?
You have too much toxicity today. The liver is too inflamed.
A month passes with no treatment, and the following week came two crushing blows.
Unfortunately, after that month's time, probably about half of the cancer came back.
That was fast.
I think even the doctors were surprised by how fast it did come back.
Diane is off the clinical trial for good.
The hardest thing is the fact that since the cancer had returned 8 years ago, we always had Tarceva in my back pocket as like the kind of the safety net to use.
Attempts to continue with Tarceva alone failed.
One of the things that they did learn is that the immunotherapies kind of heighten the side effects of another drug that you're on.
The drug she knew would give her another couple of quality years with her boys and husband.
I've had a tough week. I had to kind of share with my kids that, you know, it's a bump in the road and, you know, step back and figure out what the next steps are.
Do you regret taking part in the immunotherapy trial?
No, I don't regret trying it at all, because if I didn't try it, then I would wonder if I was missing something.
She does hope others learn from her role and approach immunotherapy with realistic expectations.
It works great for some people, but it's not the answer for everybody. I have to keep it into perspective. My cancer is probably about halfway back, but still smaller than what it was when we started 3 months ago. So I would not say it's a huge setback. It's disappointing, but it's okay. It's gonna be okay.
And just because this immunotherapy didn't work out doesn't mean she can't try again.
No, in fact, I talked to her doctor this afternoon, mm-hmm. and they are right now actively trying to figure out what to do next. She's not out of moves, not by a long shot. Mm-hmm. There's another targeted therapy drug that's like Tarceva that she can try. She's just not sure she wants to go that route. And he said that just because she failed this immunotherapy doesn't mean that she won't have success with a different one. And there are other drugs being developed.
And other people are having success, so she shouldn't be discouraged. Others shouldn't be discouraged.
In fact, Diane met someone just last week that gave her hope. Mm-hmm. He has been on this immunotherapy for like 30 treatments, 30 wow. infusions, same type of cancer as Diane, and he's doing great. So just because it didn't work for her doesn't mean it won't work for you. It's just... you can't tell who it's
Very
going to work
individual.
For until you go through it.
Yeah. Yep. Up next, expanding the possible use of immunotherapy into the brain.
Immunotherapy has now gone where few originally thought it could, into the human brain. Neurosurgeon William Curry says there were serious safety concerns.
Concerns about autoimmunity. If we take the patient's tumor cells, will we then create an immune response against the brain itself? Which, you know, could be deadly.
But operating under the belief that it was possible and potentially game-changing, Curry led a phase one clinical trial at Mass General with advanced glioblastoma patients whose options had run out.
We take the patient's tumor cells, we take them out at surgery, and then we engineer them in a specific way so that they can no longer divide. And then we create a vaccine out of that patient's tumor cells and then inject that just in the shoulder, just like a vaccine for measles, mumps, rubella. And then the cells of the immune system, the patient's natural immune system, start working together to recognize those tumor cells here.
Results were carefully measured with regular blood work for comparison.
Here, where there are like no inflammatory cells at week one.
And then over here, roughly a month later, they're having an immune response.
Exactly.
That's what that shows.
Exactly.
That response, also evident on brain scans and in how patients felt. One man's experience raised real concern initially.
About halfway through the scheduled treatment, he developed headache and weakness on the left side of the body.
His MRI, very abnormal, appeared to show rapid tumor growth. But then?
2 to 3 weeks later, basically he was better. And then also his MRI, which we repeated, showed a reduction in the volume of this abnormal tissue.
What happened throughout the body in this phase one clinical trial raised eyebrows and exciting questions.
One of the things that's unpredictable about the immunotherapy is what happens in the tumor. Like, it might get bigger first. And maybe that means that the tumor is inflamed because of your therapy. Or maybe the immune response hasn't kicked in. If you think about when you get vaccines as a kid, you don't get just one of them, you get a series of three. So you might need more time for an immune response to kick in.
Curry is cautious. The study was too small to draw conclusions, but for whatever reason, those patients lived months longer than expected.
With no side effects.
No side effects.
No side effects in our patients.
Meaning safe to try again. He's working on a more potent vaccine for a much bigger phase two trial in 2016.
I think that within the near or foreseeable future, immune-based therapies, including vaccination, will be part of the arsenal that we have. And I really think it has a chance, as we can stimulate and re-stimulate immunity against brain tumors, to turn this into a chronic or slowly progressive disease, as opposed to the fairly rapidly fatal disease that it most often is.
Dr. Curry thinks that vaccine therapy is going to become part of the standard treatment for all types of cancer. So if you have a breast tumor, mm-hmm. they would take your tumor cells, they would grow them in a laboratory and modify them, then they would inject them back into your arm as an immune-based. The idea is your body would recognize that as something foreign, it would stimulate an immune response and go after the cancer
cells. And still
cells.
Combine with traditional chemotherapy and radiation. Okay.
Yep.
That is Chronicle for tonight. Thanks very much for joining us. I'm Anthony Everett along with Heather Unruh, who has joined
Great
us tonight.
To be here.
Glad to have you here. Have a good evening. We'll see you tomorrow night.